welcome our guest of honor, respected Professor Furkhan Qamar sir, who is the Secretary General of the Association of Indian University, New Delhi. I warmly welcome, sir, with highest inspiration, I welcome you all. I warmly welcome our guest of honor, respected Naveen Mittal, sir, IAS, Commissioner of Secretary, Technical Education, Government of Telangana. I warmly welcome you, sir, for gracing this occasion. Last but not the least, I welcome all the participants who have gathered here to involve themselves into a rich and a diverse learning experience here for a week. And I'm sure this will be a very fruitful program to you all. Before inviting our honorable guests, I want to give an outlook of the program. It is a 6 days training program, and this is for the senior administrators like registrars, FOs, and deans, schools, and also the boards for college and university development. This program is in collaboration with CALM, Center for Academic Learning, Education Management, under the scheme of Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya, National Mission on Teacher and Teaching. And it is funded by MHRD, Government of India. The main purpose of this program is to make the higher education leaders to critically reflect on the challenges of current issues in higher education and to discuss and have a probable solutions to efficiently combat the same. For this, we are having FOs, registrars, heads, deans, and I'm sure this program will definitely help you in solving the problems of challenges of higher education in the field of administrators as well as in financing institutions of higher education. Now I request our Pro Vice Chancellor to give the mementos and shawl to our respected chief guest. Now I request our PVC sir to present the memento and shawl to our guest of honor, Professor Furkhan Qamar sir. Now I request our registrar sir to give the memento and shawl to our guest of honor, Mr. Naveen Mittal, sir. Before inviting our honorable chief guest, just an outlook of the program I want to give. This program was divided into 10 topics. Just I'll give the topics of it. Overview of higher education in India, issues and challenges, digital intervention in universities, financing higher education and critical role of UGC in maintenance of standards of higher education, an overview of assessment and accreditation of universities, GST related to higher education, GFR procedures, leadership strategies for better performance in higher education, transparency, vigilance, gender equity, and departmental inquiries in university system, mainstreaming gender in higher education administration, and also lastly, change a requirement in competitive world. Ladies and gentlemen, I take pleasure to inform you that eminent and renowned personalities are coming to deliver lecture on these topics. I wish and I sincerely hope all the participants will have a very fruitful and enriching program here for a week. And in this, we are having one field trip to ISB also, interacting with the eminent personality over there, Dr. Professor Rajendra Prasad, Dean of ISB, Dean of Schools in ISB. He's going to tell about the best practices of ISB. That will be on 25th of this month. Now, before calling our chief guest, just a brief introduction I want to give. Sri Ashok Thakur sir, IAS, former Secretary, Higher Education, MHRD, India. He has a postgraduate degree in history from Punjab University, Chandigarh, later was awarded diploma in international economic relations from International Institute of Public Administration, Paris. He has also been an alumni of Kennedy School of Government and also IDEA Sussex University, where he did programs on infrastructure, development in market economy and poverty reduction respectively. Since he retired in October 2014, he has been an honorary professor in public administration at Punjab University. He is also a member at Cambridge University, UK. He joined the Indian Administrative Service in 1977 and since then has held several posts including Principal Secretary, Tourism, Culture, Youth Services and Sports Industries, Forest, Home, etc. in the state government of Himachal Pradesh. At the center, he worked in the Ministry of Rural Development in the rank of Joint Secretary. He also served in Lal Bahadur Shastri National Academy of Administration, Mussoorie, as a faculty member. He joined the Department of Higher Education, Ministry of Human Resource Development as Additional Secretary, Technical Education, and later took over as Secretary, Higher Education in May 2012. During this period of more than 6 years, Ashok sir took a number of steps to improve the quality of higher education in the country by initiating reform measures through UGC, AICTE and DEC. These are the principal regulators in the country affecting the lives of more than 30 million students enrolled in more than 700 universities and 300 engineering colleges, most of which are in the private sector. Just a brief introduction I have given you. With these words, I warmly welcome you, sir, invite you, sir, to enlighten us with your valuable views.
Mr. Mittal, who is the Principal Secretary, Higher Education Government of Telangana. Our pro Vice Chancellor, who has been very warm to me. Our Registrar, who made a special invitation to me here. The Vice Chancellors who are attending the program, the Registrars, the Finance Officers, Faculty of CALAM, C-A-L-A-M, which has taken a lot of pains to make it happen here in your university. And dear participants, you see, they say that what goes around comes back with you. The past catches up with you. So this Maulana, Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya National Mission for Teachers and Training was started when I was in the 12th five-year plan when I was Secretary HRD. And what we had started that time, today I am encountering it again in your university for the first time. It is indeed a pleasure to see that what you have started today, I am seeing it in, I would say, flesh and blood actually happening. So this is something good for me personally. For the purpose of today's discussion, higher education as such is a very wide subject. I would like to be very focused. And as your course indicates, I will divide my brief talk in two parts. Number one, I want to talk about the higher education system in this country. What ails it, what bogs it down, in very brief terms. Maybe it is very subjective, but the things which I feel are important, I would like to bring before you is my perspective. And the second part, I would like to talk about what I learned and what I remember on administrative issues which the vice chancellors face, which the directors face, in higher education, and this experience is, of course, 7 years I was in MHRD, so I'll try to condense that in, again, very simple terms so that you can benefit out of it. Now coming to this problem about higher education, I would say that I would liken higher education, for the purpose of my trying to explain it to you, to a tree. It's an organic whole. This higher education is an organic whole. It is like a tree. Unfortunately, for our convenience, we break up into several parts. We break up into school section, we break it into college section, and we break it into a university section. These are all artificial barriers we have created. Actually, the tree of knowledge is one single tree. You see, it is an integrated whole. So we must look at it from that point of view today, I think. But unfortunately, what has happened, I told you, over the years we have segmented it. And much of the problems in higher education which we face today in our country is because the school education system, the base, the root is all rotten. Maybe I'm using very strong terms, maybe it is better in your state, but the states in which I am familiar with, I am very sure that the quality of school education has deteriorated over the years and to alarming proportions. And I would say that, especially in the government schools, we don't talk about it. We talk in terms of fundings. We talk about, you see, making larger allocations. It is of no use unless we make the system more focused, so that apart from money, money is welcome, but more than money, I think it is a function of some of the right steps to be taken. To begin with, I would say that at least my experience of the states where I have had things to deal with it is that there is a very cozy relationship between the political masters and the teachers' associations and unions. Nobody wants to take this aspect head on, because for obvious reasons, teachers are scattered throughout the rural areas or in interior places, throughout in urban areas. So they exercise a lot of clout, which can, they think, influence the voting pattern. I'm trying to put it very nakedly. So with the result that nobody bothers these unions. These unions are very, very powerful. Even in a small state like mine in Himachal, very powerful, very powerful. They can determine, make or mar governments or several assembly seats. So this is the kind of fear which has come about, and the political requirements have taken precedence over the future of our children. I think which is very, very shocking. And the sooner we realize it and sooner we try to grapple with it, the better. We have Mr. Mittal with us. He knows things better from the current point of view, from the point of view of your own state government. All I can say that this can be done. My experience at MHRD as vice chairman of Kendriya Vidyalaya for about 5 years I was there. Apart from higher education, I was also looking. Therefore, I am seeing from both the perspectives. How does Kendriya Vidyalayas, how do they manage to get such good results? They've been able to do it because of three things. First is the selection process of the teachers is perfect. In fact, it is by and large on the UPSC model, and it is not done by Kendriya Vidyalaya, it is outsourced to a third party. EDSIL does it on their behalf. So the person whom you get as a teacher of your school is taken on the basis of merit and not because of some chit by some MLA or he is aligned to certain political party that he's there. So this is number one. Number two, their promotion system is foolproof. There was one commissioner, you know, individuals can make a lot of difference, and I keep quoting him. guy from Assam Kada, Mr. Kere. Very tough and no-nonsense kind of officer. He was there before I was even there, but I used to hear stories about him, that how he introduced systems. He had a good system of promotion, good system of selection, as I told you, and a fairly good and transparent system of transfers. Transfers is a big deal in state governments. So if you have taken care of these three things, selection, promotions, and transfers, I think you have won the battle. I think if Kendriya Vidyalayas, which are a government body, it has not been created by any private sector or some foreign, it is our own Indian system which has created, it is our own Indian government which has done it, the state governments need to learn from it. And for once, they should all say that education is not for politics. Education is for the future of our country. If your building blocks are rotten and weak, how can you have good colleges? How can you have gold standard universities? I fail to understand. Now that's the kind of thinking we should go, and there's a lot of responsibility of the colleges and universities to up the standard of our schools. I think there are schools of education in many universities. I think your contribution could be to please emphasize on that. The schools of education are a very critical tool in strengthening this particular point which I'm trying to make. This is my point number one. So like I said, it is, you are likening it to a tree. This is the root portion I'm talking about. Schools are the root. Now I come to the next point, which is the trunk and the branches, which is the university. I think we have some misplaced idea about, I keep talking with Professor Furkan Kamar on this, we have some misplaced notion of a university. Universities throughout the world, when you say universities, they have to be autonomous. A university which is not autonomous is an oxymoron. It's a contradictory. It's a contradiction in terms. But in India, I will say Indian characteristics, like Chinese use the Chinese characteristics, I think this, the model which we have is a totally Indian model by which you could be a university but still under various things. I think we, at some point of time, maybe with good intention, but the end result has been fairly disastrous, that we created these regulators. These regulators are super universities. The default nature of a university is autonomous. But we have created UGC, maybe with good intentions, but the net result is different. UGC, if you read the Act, UGC fixes minimum standards, okay? UGC fixes minimum standards because they have to take care of an array of universities. And when we talk about minimum standards, gradually in practice what has happened, these minimum standards have become maximum standards. Oh, this we have done, this we have done, this we have done. So unfortunate point is that this minimum has become the maximum. And as you all know, if the gates are low, then only the midgets will pass through. The larger institutions cannot go through that gate. There's an automatic stoppage to that. That is the reason I was reading the other day, the IIMs, though they have been given autonomy, they have come under an act, but they are still wary about using the degree of MBA, because they feel that once we use the nomenclature of MBA, which is a UGC degree, there'll be a whole lot of restrictions imposed on us. And IIMs, where they are today, will then be compared, their standards will be compared and linked to the worst IIM institution that you see in the streets of probably Hyderabad also. So unless we improve our firstly, I feel that this whole UGC should gradually withdraw from this, too much of interference. UGC has very powerful tools. The regulations made by UGC and AICT are like law. So, and apart from the legal aspect of it and making regulations, it has a huge funding clout. So the institutions which were even flying have come down to earth because they want funds. Forget about the regulations. So with these two instruments, as I observed, I was on the UGC board also, and what I have observed is because of their power of regulation, because of their power of funding clout, I would say, they have become a super university. And it caters, as I said, to the lowest common denominator, which has been very, very adverse. We have been talking about graded autonomy. I think it's a good, I personally feel that graded autonomy scheme has a lot of advantages to it. At least this is the first step, let us say. First step towards the A grade institutions are set free, or they, at least it is said that they'd be set free. So I think I would like to look at it from the positive point of view and say it's a good step. But then what about our measuring instrument? What is the measuring instrument you have said? We said this is A, this is B, this is C. NAC, as I have seen in the ministry, is a creation of UGC. ये तो वही बात होगी कि थानेदार भी आप हैं और जज भी आप हैं. UGC makes regulations, UGC approves institutions, and UGC will also, because for all practical purposes, NAC is not an independent body. Those of you who do not know, I would like to say he's appointed. In fact, he is a functionary of the chairman of UGC. He appoints the director of NAC. So it is very important that NAC should be set free, first of all. The measuring instrument hai aapka, wo to bilkul sahi hona chahiye na. Vyaktigat dekh ke aap chhota aur bada karna, wo nahi hona chahiye. NAC ko independent karna bahut bahut zaruri hai, autonomous. Bilkul UGC se alag dhalak kariye usko. Tab aap ki naap napai bilkul sahi rahegi, aur tab aap bol sakte haan, isko autonomy dijiye, isko na dijiye. But at least the rules of the game should be very, very clear, and it should be transparent. This is point number two, which I wanted to make. And point number three is about you people, the faculty. I have talked about the root. I have talked about the trunk and the branches. But I want to talk about the what is that energy. You don't see it. But what is that energy, that vital energy which flows through the trunk? It is the sap. It carries all the nutrients from the roots to the trunk, to the leaves, to the students. So I think teachers have such an important role. And therefore, when we talk about national mission on teachers and training, I think now we have finally come after so many years and trying to bark up the right tree. So teachers have a very important role. I think the primary role of a teacher, as I see, is to ignite a sense of curiosity in the minds of the students. If you're not able to ignite a sense of curiosity amongst your students, then I think you need to really change yourself. This is role number one of a teacher, the basic role of a teacher. Child's mind should be, you know, made to imagine, made to roam freely. That's number one. Number two, creation of knowledge, research. Knowledge not only for your own country or your own community or your own institution, knowledge for humanity. That is the largest, highest form of contribution that a teacher can make. I think both teaching and research are very sacred aspects which need to be carried forward. I feel that from 6th CPC, Central Pay Commission onwards, As far as salaries are concerned, we have no, there should be no grounds. So that aspect has been taken care of, but now the teachers have also to rise to the occasion and take up the challenge. It can be done through various things. Institutions themselves should develop a system of best practices. I personally feel that practices like career advancement schemes, where you have automatic promotions, should be discouraged. Similarly, inbreeding, which is eating into the vital, nobody talks about it. None of the regulations of UGC talks about inbreeding. But inbreeding is slow poisoning. We never realize it. Because a student who has done PhD from the same institution, if he slides into faculty positions there, it is less challenging and it is not fair to the system. He should, like in the IITs, when you do, you have to, after doing your PhD, you have to work for several years outside. Prove yourself there, then you can come back. But automatic, this sliding system is very, very, I would say, in the long run, it doesn't pay. Then each university has a system I have observed of selection of teachers, which is by and large customized. The existing faculty has a lot of role in selecting the existing, the new set of teachers. I've often seen that here again, people from outside universities, people from who have, may have taught in the best universities abroad, are not taken in. They're very strong gatekeepers there. So I think they should loosen up, and the interest of the institution, the university, should be paramount. So these are the three broad outlines which I have made with regard to the higher education thing. I'll now briefly touch upon what I remember about the administrative side. First of all, let me tell you that I was taken aback by the difficulty we used to face in MHRD, because I used to be on the selection committee of all vice chancellors, all directors of IITs. And most difficult thing in India today is to get a person who is top class in his subject, yet is an able administrator. Big, big challenge for us. Or else people who are like that, they're shy of coming forward. So therefore, I used to call them tigers, tiger and lion, combination of both, which is so rare. He should be a tiger in his subject and a lion as far as his administrative skills are concerned. So you should look out for tigers. And vice chancellors should try to identify such people at a young stage. See who are the prominent people who can become vice chancellors, who can become, you know, can hold offices which have both role of academics as well as teaching. So nurturing them, you should nurture them, savor them, so that tomorrow the future is intact. Another tendency which I observed is that a person is a vice chancellor for 5 years, he got selected, or a director of an IIT gets selected at the age of 60. He puts in his 5 years, then refuses to move from there. Not a good thing, not a good idea. Very detrimental to the interest of higher education. He should move out. This is my view. I'm sorry if it affects, if you don't agree with it, but this is my personal observation. I used to always say that 5 years is enough, and you should then let it open to young people. You see, young people who have more, at least some good ideas will come about. So it is very important to develop a second line of leadership. That is my point number one, which I'm trying to make on the administrative side. Another thing, second point which I want to make on the administrative side is that, this is again very subjective, may not be applying to you people. We have gradually cannibalized the role of the registrars. In the IIT system, registrar's post is a statutory post. But still, for some reason which I cannot understand, faculty people love to take administrative roles, which I personally feel there's so much of faculty shortage in our country, and then leave administration to the people who aren't from administration. This would be my second humble advice to you people. Because when it is done, then responsibility is fixed. When you have a nebulous kind of system, then no responsibility is fixed. It is because of this that I was telling Professor Furkan Kamar today when we were walking, that IIT Bombay has lost about 100 acres of land in the heart of Bombay in Powai. Because there was no responsibility, there was no direct way of dealing with it. Similarly, some other universities have lost huge chunks of land. So it is very important that you have an administrative person. He should be fixed. He should be accountable for it. Then on the finance side, I would say that it's very important that the money which you get from MHRD is utilized properly and in time, because money sitting there not doing anything is a big national loss apart from any other thing. So these are some of the thoughts which come to my mind. I will close with that. But once again, I would like to say that it's been a pleasure to be back amongst some of my colleagues, my friends from UGC, for whom I have great regard, especially Professor Furkan Kamar, your registrar, Sikandar. Slightly going outside the topic, he was in a very difficult assignment in NBA, National NBT. And the amount of heel digging that he used to do, that means that you don't give up. He's one of the guys who will never give up. And it's very good that he's here and he will do your university proud. Similarly, your Pro VC, he was in UGC that time. I've interacted with him, and he will be an asset for all of you. Thank you very much.
Now I request our guest of honor, Professor Furkan Kamar sir, to say a few words. Before inviting sir, I just want to give a brief report about his biodata. His area of expertise is education. Professor Furkan Kamar sir, in his present position as the Secretary General of the Association of Indian Universities, is the Principal Executive Officer of the largest and one of the oldest network of universities. In his illustrious career, Dr. Kamar sir has held the position of the Vice Chancellor of the University of Rajasthan and the Central University of Himachal Pradesh. He has also served as advisor education in the Planning Commission of India. Essentially a professor of management, he has keen research interest in public policy, planning, administration and financing of higher education, and has numerous publications in journals of repute of his credit. Professor Kamar sir has chaired and been member of a large number of committees, working groups at the national and international level. Dr. Furkan Kamar sir brings with him academic eminence, leadership qualities, and exposure to best global practices. With this short brief, I invite sir to enlighten us with your valuable views.
Guest of honor on the panel, Naveen Mittal sir, registrar of the university. I also assume that he is providing leadership to this Human Resource Development Center. Sikandar sir, coordinator of the program, all the participants from this university and also from several other universities. I'll be very brief because I have another session post lunch, but want to say a few things. Although much of what one could have said on this inaugural has already been said by Ashok Thakur sir, and obviously so. I mean, with long years of experience in higher education, and not only in terms of numbers of years, but in terms of very, very active involvement. And because of that, he has said it all, that education is an integrated whole. There are backward and forward linkages between higher education and school education. Much of the problem that we see in higher education could be because of the poor quality of school education. But I, having been always in the higher education, would say that much of the problem that you see in school education is also because of higher education. Because ultimately the teachers for school education do come from higher education. I'm so happy and delighted that this Pandit Madan Mohan Malviya National Mission on Teachers and Training, which I recently came to know that in bureaucratic circle is referred to as PM Square, NT Square. I don't know which one is easier to mention, but I'm so happy that this mission has been conceptualized. It has many components, but one of the components is on leadership development. The development of leadership at the level of the vice chancellors, but also at the level of the heads, deans, directors, and a plethora of middle level and senior level educational administrator. Besides everything that Ashok Thakur ji said, one of the reasons is that our institutions have not been able to have the kind of leadership at all levels which is necessary for making them a quality institutions. I do not mean to say that other factors are not responsible. Rather, I have very strongly been saying that unless we ensure three things, funds, faculty, freedom, cannot be quality institutions. So these three F's are extremely necessary. By funds, I do not mean just funds in large quantity, but funds which also come with flexibility for the institutions used for the purposes of the institutions. Faculty, not only that we need them in large number, but a faculty that knows its role. Just on a lighter side, somebody claimed that I have taught my dog to talk. People were surprised. They said, okay, we have seen people teaching their parrots and minors to talk, but never heard of a dog being taught to talk. He said, yes, I have taught my dog to talk. And then somebody said that, okay, let me test whether your dog can speak or can talk. And obviously the dog could not talk. He said, you are telling a lie. You have been telling a lie that you claimed that you taught your dog to talk. He said, I did not tell a lie, but you did not listen to me properly. I only claimed that I taught my dog to speak or to talk. I never claimed that my dog also learned to talk. I think we need teacher who know the distinction between teaching and learning. We need teacher who are committed for learning. Learning of not their students, but learning of themselves. Themselves continuously keep on learning and growing with the rapid changes that are taking place. So it's extremely important. Of course, Ashok Thakur ji said that autonomy is extremely important, and this autonomy is built in. Universities are essentially born autonomous. Otherwise, there are no reasons that the universities should have had their act or statutes or ordinance. The fact that these statutes, ordinances, provide them power to make their own law, to take their own decisions, essentially says that the universities are born autonomous. But over a period of time, most of the powers that universities had has been circumscribed or taken over, or some people would use the harsh word, or being usurped by various kinds of regulation and the order, etc. Had that led to improving the quality? Had that led to universities being more effective? We should have been happier. But the problem is, and I had recently published an article almost a year ago, now based on empirical data, where the conclusion that we reached, sir, and you had seen that article, that quality of higher education in fact becomes inversely proportional to the intensity of the regulation. And the data shows this. So universities are autonomous, have to be autonomous, and this autonomy must be protected. But in order to protect this autonomy, we cannot claim that the universities cannot be accountable. Because autonomy or freedom does not mean freedom to do whatever we inside the university, vice chancellor, registrar, or teachers want to do. But universities are created for the society. Even private universities are created for the society, because the essential argument that is advanced is that this is needed for the general social, cultural, economic development of the society, and also to prepare manpower. So the society has certain expectations. And therefore, we have to rise to meet what the society expects. If we do not meet those expectations, then chances are that despite whatever we say with all sincerities, the autonomy is more likely to be taken over, because invariably the pretext for taking over the autonomy is that you are not delivering on the counts for which you were established. So you talk to people who have been vice chancellors, now many of them are no more, in old bitter days of Bombay, Calcutta, Madras, Allahabad, Punjab University, the vice chancellors, the faculty members almost had absolute power to decide. But then gradually those powers were taken over, because they, in terms of tangible outcome, could not justify that they exercised their power for the purposes for which the universities were created. Just to cite you one example, that if you do that, you are able to justify. Professor A.M. Khosrow, you are very familiar with him. He was vice chancellor of Aligarh Muslim University. I am told that during his tenure as vice chancellor, he bypassed all the governmental approval, UGC approval, etc., and he started many new programs, hired many new teachers, creating liability of during those times about 2 crore for the University Grants Commission. Of course, this became an audit para. UGC also, and the audit para could not be settled, and UGC was also after him, that you exercised your powers beyond what was vested, and therefore the matter went to Parliamentary Accounts Committee. And Professor Khosrow was called, and I was told by Mr. Chhabra, who was then Secretary of Education, he is still, I believe, alive, that Professor Khosrow, in his deposition, rather than explaining that why he created X department or Y department, he gave almost half an hour lecture of India, problem of India's economic development, Aligarh Muslim University, role of Aligarh Muslim University, and the kind of expectation that Aligarh Muslim University has from the nation. And just in one sentence, he said that everything that I did can be justified on these counts. For example, I started polytechnic, started so many programs, but all of those people got employed in the Asia Games and so on and so forth, and the para was dropped. Maybe during those days, the politicians and the bureaucrats were rather more in line than today. But also, Professor Khusro has been able to do this because Professor Khusro himself was standing on a firmer ground as a very strong, sound researcher with credibility, and therefore his actions were measured in terms of his intentions and the intention that he explained. But supposing if somebody else, not as strong a researcher, perhaps he would have had much weaker ground to stand on and would have had more bashing. The point that I simply want to make is that every freedom comes with some conditions. Absolute freedom does not exist. Old adage, which we all studied in school days, that my freedom, move my hand, ends where somebody else's nose begins. So all freedom comes constrained. But then the essential crux of measuring and having more of that freedom is justifying your existence in terms of expectations from the society. And therefore, escaping from our responsibilities can never be used to justify that we are autonomous and therefore nobody should ask questions. You talk to parliamentarians, you talk to MLAs, they will say that, look, everything that you are saying about freedom, autonomy is all fine, but then we represent people and people ask us questions and therefore we are accountable to legislature, we are accountable to parliamentarians. So we should have to assume that that responsibility exists. And that is where the role of this heads of the departments, deans of the faculties, and extending to larger teacher becomes very, very critical. For two reasons. One is obvious, that future leadership of the universities has come from where? What Ashok Thakur was hinting, that is extremely difficult to find an eminent academician interested in taking over leadership position and also has the necessary administrative acumen. That will be possible only when those administrators, those teachers, those researchers, when they were heads, when they were deans, when they were individual teachers, they were gaining experience of that. One phenomena is a global phenomena. Best universities of the world had very good vice chancellors, but there are very rare examples of Nobel laureates becoming vice chancellors. They never come forward. They are so engrossed in their research that nobody even in fact dare to ask them to become vice chancellor, or they would not come. There have been examples when they have been masters or principals of the colleges, but they rarely come. So it is the second best who normally come. I think we should realize this, that even in India we should leave those who are so engrossed in research and create such a condition that they go on focusing on their research and go on opening new frontiers of knowledge. Do not burden them with the administrative kind of leadership responsibilities. But even the second best should be ready. And the gap between the best and the Nobel laureates and the rest should not be as wide or as huge as we often see in our country. There are many things that have been responsible. And I think it's now time for you all to keep on reflecting. Presently, I realize that there is a kind of mistrust that is prevailing in the system, that nobody trusts anybody. The minister may not trust his team may not trust the vice chancellor may not trust the dean may not trust the head may not trust the teacher. But no system can function under this kind of mistrust. After all, what does the university stand for? How are the contribution of the universities measured? The contribution of the university is nothing but the sum total of the contribution made by each and every individual, that is the student and the teacher, and also the non-teaching staff. And therefore, we have to rely, we have to depend on, and we have to create conditions for all of them to perform. This training program or this 6-day program that you are participating in may only expose you or sensitize you to certain issues, will not make you perfect in terms of administration, in terms of leadership. But this exposure, you can then yourself start developing on it. I have done quick surveys that how many of our teachers or heads and deans have gone through the act and statutes and the ordinances of their university. So ask the question yourself that whether you are a majority or a minority. If the number is a majority, we should be very happy. If the number is a minority, then it's a point of concerns. Because if you are part of a system, and if we only know that part of the ordinance or the act and the statutes which defines my rights, then perhaps it's not a full reading. When we are fully aware, familiar, this is one set of questions. Second survey question that could be there is that given the opportunity, although such opportunities are rare, university systems are highly centralized system, we as vice chancellors demand freedom and autonomy from government, but we in turn are not as much willing to give autonomy to our own deans and heads generally, largely. But supposing given the opportunity, are we ready to use my power without fear and without favor and in an impartial manner and in a responsible manner? We did a small experiment that while framing the ordinances of the Central University of Himachal Pradesh, we decentralized the governance administration, and many things did not need to come to the vice chancellors as registrars. The deans were empowered, heads were empowered. But safe example, power to sanction leave is decentralized rather than the vice chancellor doing it. But then if at the top leadership you find and the student coming in that my classes are not being held and the heads and deans saying that yes, all my teachers are on leave, it means somewhere we did not exercise our power responsibly. Because as head or as dean, your duty was primarily to ensure that all teaching learning processes takes place. And therefore, when you are sanctioning leave, whenever there is a case of power, it makes you powerful, it makes you liked by many, but at the same time, when you exercise your power, many people may also not like you. But the real test, the litmus test that lies in is that taking the right kind of decisions. And this applies to so on, so I think we need to be prepared. I am the last person to be willing, and therefore anybody, anytime when a vice chancellor said that this university is what it is because of him and takes all credit, I say that it cannot be, because the university is a collective contribution. And therefore you all have to contribute. And therefore if the university fails, I would be the last person to give all the blames to the vice chancellor. I'll say that collectively the university failed, and so on and so forth. So I think this training of a week would only sensitize you on different issues. but much would depend on your own efforts, that how do you benefit from this opportunity. Believe me, we all have grouse. We all keep on saying that higher education is not as good in the country as it should be, but we all also share the blame and the responsibility. So if tomorrow, in future, the leadership is likely to be chosen from amongst you, and if you are not ready, of course, the system would not function. So there are varieties of issues, and therefore I am very happy that this kind of programs have been conceptualized, and I am thankful to Dr. Shakil for giving me this opportunity to be here. The more about higher education systems and processes, I'll be interacting with you post-lunch. Thank you very much for your patient listening.
Thank you, sir, for your very informative, thought-provoking and valuable thoughts. It's a privilege for me to introduce Mr. Naveen Mittal, sir. He's a commissioner and secretary, Government of Telangana. He belongs to the 1996 batch of the Indian Administrative Service assigned to the Telangana cadre. He is a B.Tech in Computer Science and engineer from the prestigious Indian Institute of Technology, Delhi. I welcome you, sir, to enlighten us with your valuable views.
Dr. Bill Grammy, my dear friends who are present here, very good morning to all of you. First of all, I must say that I'm really happy to be here for this program. The very fact that the nomenclature of the program is Academic Leadership and Education Management explains the, I would say these are the real keywords which are very, very relevant to the need of the present times. And both Thakur sir and Professor Kamar have very, very, I would say, dexterously explained the issues which are involved and the importance of finding solutions to many of the problems which we are finding today. I'm working in this department for the last 3.5 months. I've had, in fact, a lot of exposure to the school education department, especially working at the grassroots, so I can really understand the issues which Thakur sir was mentioning about the problems at the school education. But when I joined this department, I was also pleasantly surprised by the fact that the overall, if you see the quality and the capability of the faculty, I was really impressed when I joined the department. In fact, we are having 131 government colleges in the department, apart from 6 general universities and 5 specialized universities. And in our 131 government colleges, we found more than 200 PhDs. And when I'm interacting with many of them, I'm finding that a lot of them have this zeal to do something and to be part of this improvement process. But there are really some critical issues involved. One of them is this whole issue of, I would say, decentralization or centralization, decentralization versus centralization. I'm reminded of a principle called principle of subsidiarity. That principle says that a thing should be done at a level where it is most efficient to be done. For example, let's say if you look at the governance structure, water supply, who is the most competent to do that, whether it is at a village level or at a sub-district level or a district level or a state level or at a national level. So similarly, if you look at higher education, I think what is really required is to find out what is to be done at what level from the perspective of efficiency. But this is not all. Professor Kamar mentioned about these issues of once you delegate, then the kind of problems which emerge. In fact, in our Department of Higher Education, we have recently decentralized a lot of powers right up to the colleges right up to the field functionaries and the regional directors. The requirement is also to balance out accountability and responsibility also. I'm reminded of a very, very interesting saying somebody said, accountability without responsibility is very, very dangerous. Is actually accountability without responsibility is very, very meaningless, and responsibility without accountability is again meaningless. These two have to go together. The power and responsibility both have to go hand in hand. If you just give powers without a responsibility, it becomes very dangerous. And if you give only responsibility without giving powers, it is of no meaning. And that is something which is required in every university and every institution. I think a clear cut evaluation has to be done. What is to be done at what level? And then, if it is to be done, what are the relevant accountability or responsibility measures which have to be brought in from that perspective? And that is something which will, I would say, bring in lot of transformation. And it has to start from very top, I mean, from the level of ministry, UGC, from the state departments, from state councils, as well as universities, central administration to the departments. The second thing which I want to emphasize, and I've been talking to a lot of principals and lecturers also from the government colleges, because we have been also trying to reorganize and rationalize a lot of our courses. We find that many courses where there is demand, we are not offering, and many courses where there's no demand, we are offering, and there are no takers for it. Because we have a very beautiful centralized system, I'll explain to you about that in the next session, which is called DOS, the degree online system for Telangana, wherein we have brought in centralized admission process for all the colleges, both government, private, and university colleges in the state. So we have now a lot of data available, which we are trying to evaluate and then bringing a lot of rationalization. And I was talking to our principals and trying to find out why students choose a particular course. And some of the answers which I got were shocking. And things like, because there's nothing else to be done, students get admission and they just want a degree. And one of the principals said that, in private colleges, the attendance is not very, very compulsory, but in government colleges, since we have compulsory attendance, students are not wanting to come in there. Then I asked this basic question, I mean, why are we running these colleges? Are we running these colleges just to distribute a degree so that a student doesn't come and we still ensure that he or she takes up the exam and then get a degree end of the day? Is it that we want? Is it the reason that we are having these courses in university because somebody just wants a 2 or 3 letters after his name or on his biodata? Is that the reason? And I think that is also something where we need to spend our time and energy on, as to why are we running a particular program? What is the objective of it? Whom do we want to come in? And what is the end result or future which a student, when he or she does that program, what is the future? Whether it is for a job in a private market, or whether it is to become an entrepreneur, or it is because the student, after doing it, wants to get into the academic side of it, or it is just for sort of a capacity building of the student to get more knowledge. And it's a very kind of generic knowledge, general capability which is getting added. And that is something which I don't think we have really thought through at the university levels and at college levels as to why are we running a program. And this is something which very, very clearly came out when we were sitting down, and the process is still on, as to why are we running a particular program in our college or in our university. What is the objective of it? Unless until this objective is clear, talking about quality is meaningless. Because what is the end result, if that is not very clearly known, how can the input be customized or designed according to that requirement? I've been through an institute which is rated pretty high in a country as well as across the world. And I have seen some best practices. Some of them have now come into our education system, which is semester-based, credit-based choice system, which was there almost 25 years back when we were studying in IIT. But I think there's also increasing need for making this choice-based credit system more and more flexible. Because right now, many of our courses and many of our degrees are still very, very compartmentalized. For example, a BSc in maths, physics, chemistry. A standard program across the state, a standard thing across it. I mean, do you want students who do not get into an engineering college and want to pursue science for the, is that the only combination which is there? Maths, physics, chemistry. BA in most government colleges, history, economics, political science. History, economics, political science. Is that the combination which should be the default combination? I mean, when a new college is sanctioned, I find these are the four courses which are offered: BA, HEP, BSc, MPC, BSc, BZC, Botany, Zoology, Chemistry, and BCom General. Standard programs for the college. Do you want that many students to have learned only history or political science? Is it really relevant for their careers? And that is something which probably at the university level and at the state level we have not really thought through, as to when we are saying it is a choice-based credit system, what are the choices we are offering? Because still our choices are very, very kind of compartmentalized. And I think we need to go a full step forward to bring in much more flexibility into our programs and better serve the needs of the student as well as the better address to the needs of the economy or the society around, rather than very, very kind of compartmentalized programs. Another thing I can emphasize upon, because most of you are from the academic leadership side, is that still our use of IT resources is very, very, very minimal. Very minimal. I mean, I can tell you in our government colleges, hardly any use of IT. And because of that, a huge amount of time which should be actually, which can actually be saved, is actually spent just to fill up registers which nobody sees. I mean, I was going through some of the things which are maintained. Academic audit, which is a requirement for NAC. And registers after registers are filled up, which nobody goes through. And which can be a very, very simply an IT-driven process. A lot of these administrative things can be IT-driven. I mean, a leave has to be applied. Why should a letter need to go and, you know, a file needs to be processed on that? A lot of these things can be IT-driven. Some of the universities have started using it, but I would say that I was looking around and I didn't really find a full-fledged university information and management system which is relevant for a country. Almost none exists. And also for a college management system, almost none exists. I mean, I saw through some of the demos. Very, 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 very kind of primitive systems. And that is something which is really required. I mean, the more we use IT for our administration, for our timetable preparation, for our academic monitoring, the better it is going to be in the future. And I think the last one which I would like to emphasize is the fact that there are lot of areas where we can go into a very kind of a collaborative setup, and universities need to collaborate, especially within the state. Universities need to collaborate. For example, we are having 6 general universities in Telangana: the Osmania, the Telangana University, MG University, Satavana University, Palmuru University. There are these 6 universities. There are a lot of things which the universities can actually collaborate and then work upon without the need for depending on an external entity like a state level organization or a UGC level organization. In my previous assignment, I was in Japan when I was handling this municipal administration and urban development, and I found that the local bodies there collaborated for waste management, because they found that in Tokyo the space for waste management was not available in every single municipality. So there are 23 municipalities which got together for waste management. And why not the universities collaborate for a lot of things which are common? And if it can be done, there's no need for a third party or a third agency to come in. I would end my address here. We have another session. We will talk about certain things in greater detail. But I must say that I'm happy to be here in this morning and be able to share some of my thoughts, and also having the privilege of hearing Thakur Saab and Professor Kamma, and thoughts from all of you also. Thank you.
कि उन्होंने हमारा दावतनामा कबूल किया और इतना अपना टाइम निकाल कर यहाँ मानू आए. रियली आई कन्वे माई सिंसियर थैंक्स ऑन बिहाफ ऑफ मानू ऑल ऑफ यू सर. अभी जो बात निकली है कि सब यूजीसी की आई एम वर्किंग देयर ऑन डेपुटेशन फ्रॉम यूजीसी ग्रांट कमीशन, सुपर यूनिवर्सिटी की बात हुई है, कहीं ना कहीं जिम्मेदार यूनिवर्सिटी के लोग, सुपर यूनिवर्सिटी जो यूजीसी को कहा जाता है, समवेयर हमने ही उनको मौका दिया है. तो हमें किसी हद तक इस टाइप के प्रोग्राम जो होंगे वो गैप को फिल करेंगे. ये भी बात होती है कि समटाइम गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया MHRDC भी सुपर बॉस है यूजीसी की, तो वो कहीं ना कहीं यूजीसी की कमी रही है. आज के लिए बड़ी खुशी का मौका जो तीनों बैठे हुए, उसे मैं अपने लिए कहूंगा. सिकंदर ने भी सर के अंडर में काम किया, ठाकुर साहब के अंडर में. मैंने भी क्योंकि यूजीसी में रहने के बाद, क्योंकि सर का साहब का लंबा पीरियड रहा है यूनिवर्सिटी MHRDC के अंदर एज ए सेक्रेटरी और एडिशनल सेक्रेटरी, कहीं ना कहीं हमने उनकी डांट, कहीं ना कहीं हमने उनका प्यार पाया. वी हैव लर्न सो मैनी थिंग्स फ्रॉम हिम. तो उनके साथ उन्होंने हमें काम सिखाया है, क्योंकि चेयरमैन यूजीसी के बाद डायरेक्टली सेक्रेटरी यूजीसी काफ़ी इम्पॉर्टेंट रोल प्ले करते हैं. एज फार एज फुरकान कमर साहब इज कंसर्न, ही गाइडेड मी फॉर माई रिसर्च, तो एक तरीके से वो मेरे उस्ताद हैं. नवीन मित्तल साहब, फ्रीक्वेंटली वी आर डिस्कसिंग ओवर इश्यूज रिलेटेड टू हायर एजुकेशन. कभी ना कभी फोन पे कुछ ना कुछ बात होती रहती है. दो आफ्टर कमिंग टू हैदराबाद उनके साथ मीटिंग नहीं हुई, लेकिन टेलीफोन पर ज़रूर बात होती रहती है. लेकिन आज वो आए और हमारे साथ बैठे, तो बहुत बहुत शुक्रिया. एक जो फुरकान कमर साहब ने इशारा किया ना ऑटोनॉमी के बारे में, और हमारे सेक्रेटरी साहब ने भी, मुझे व्हेन आई वाज ओनली 23 इयर्स ओल्ड, आई वाज इन दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी, आई वाज वर्किंग विद प्रोफेसर मुनी सर, आई वाज वाइस चांसलर. तो मैं एक वाक्य जो उन्होंने खुसरो साहब का सुनाया, क्या हुआ उस टाइम पर कंप्यूटर का जोर था. यूनिवर्सिटी ग्रांट्स कमीशन ने कंप्यूटर वगैरह इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर डेवलप करने के लिए सारे पैसे दे दिए, और ये कहा कि पोस्ट हम 6 महीने बाद देंगे आपको, पोस्ट बाद में ले लीजिएगा. जब 6 महीने गुजर गए, फिर हम लोगों ने चिट्ठी लिखी यूजीसी को कि भाई पोस्ट दे दीजिए, तो वहाँ से आया कि भाई पोस्ट नहीं दे सकते, आपको जो देना था वो दे दिए. तो एट दैट टाइम प्रोफेसर यशपाल वाज द चेयरमैन ऑफ द यूजीसी. आप जानते हैं यशपाल साहब बहुत एमिनेंट आदमी थे. तो प्रोफेसर मुनीस साहब की बात हुई, भाई आप अगर पोस्ट वगैरह नहीं दे रहे तो मैं ये कंप्यूटर जो दिए हैं या यूजीसी वापस भिजवा देता हूँ मैम। आप यकीन जानिए फौरन इमरजेंट मीटिंग हुई और नेक्स्ट डे जो पोस्ट मांगी थी मुनीस साहब ने वो लेटर आ गया। तो ये सारी चीज़ें सिस्टम के अंदर होती हैं। तो मुझे जो शॉर्ट में ये कहना है कि क्योंकि 11:30 से नवीन मित्तल साहब दूसरा सेशन लेंगे और फुल सेशन होगा, वो उसमें काफ़ी चीज़ें हम सीखेंगे। ये प्रोग्राम बहुत इम्पॉर्टेंट है दो वजह से। एक तो ये है कि जो गवर्नेंस की बात करते हैं यूनिवर्सिटी, जो मैंने फील किया है क्योंकि मैं यूनिवर्सिटी सिस्टम में, मैं दिल्ली यूनिवर्सिटी में मैंने काफ़ी दिनों तक सर्व किया, उसके बाद फिर मैं फंडिंग एजेंसी में यूजीसी में फॉर द लास्ट 12 ईयर्स आई एम वर्किंग देयर, और फिर मुझे मौका मिला सर्व करने का मानू सेंट्रल यूनिवर्सिटी। बट आई फील कि एक डेफिसिट ट्रस्ट है बिटवीन जो हेड और डिपार्टमेंट हैं या डीन्स वगैरह हैं। उसका रीज़न ये भी हो सकता है कि मैंने चीज़ें जानते नहीं हैं, उनको सीखने की ज़रूरत है या उनको वो अपॉर्चुनिटी प्रोवाइड करने की ज़रूरत है कि वो जाने, काफ़ी चीज़ें हद तक सॉल्व हो सकती हैं। ये डाइवर्स ग्रुप है, इसमें हेड ऑफ़ द डिपार्टमेंट्स हैं, डीन ऑफ स्कूल्स हैं, फैकल्टीज़ हैं, रजिस्ट्रार हैं, फाइनेंस ऑफिसर, कंट ऑफ एग्जामिनेशन है। डेफिनेटली ये प्रोग्राम जो उनको हेल्प करेगा कि कैसे वो इनलाइटन हो, चीज़ों को गवर्नेंस जो कहलाते हैं हम गुड गवर्नेंस, उसमें काफ़ी मदद करेगा ये सीखने के बाद। और मुझे ये लगता है कि जो आजकल जैसा ठाकुर साहब ने ये कहा, इशारा दिया है कि आज भी कल रात में बात कर रहे थे हम लोग कि यूनिवर्सिटी को चलाना ज़रा मुश्किल है एज़ कम्पेयर टू अदर ऑर्गेनाइजेशन, या कॉम्प्लेक्स एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन है क्योंकि ओनली वन एंड स्टूडेंट हैं, दूसरी तरफ टीचर्स हैं, थर्ड नॉन टीचिंग स्टाफ है, तो इट इज़ नॉट ईजी टू रन द यूनिवर्सिटी स्मूथली। तो कहीं ना कहीं हमें और अच्छा होने की ज़रूरत है, क्योंकि अच्छी तरीके से डील करने के लिए चीज़ों का क्लैरिटी बहुत ज़रूरी है। जैसे हम लोगों को यही नहीं पता कि हमारे एक्ट क्या कहता है, स्टेच्यूट क्या कहता है, रेगुलेशन क्या कहता है, फंडिंग एजेंसी का रोल क्या रहता है, क्योंकि मैंने देखा है जो जिस टाइप के रिप्रेजेंटेशन हमारे पास आते हैं, जैसे फॉर एग्जांपल अगर यूजीसी कह रही है रेगुलेशन कहता है भाई आपको वन रिफ्रेशर कोर्स करना है, वन एक ओरिएंटेशन प्रोग्राम करना है, तो रिप्रेजेंटेशन आते हैं भाई इसको माफ़ कर दीजिए, हाउ इज पॉसिबल फॉर द वाइस चांसलर और द रजिस्ट्रार के इसको एग्जाम कर दें, क्योंकि वो बाइंडिंग है, नहीं हो सकता। ज़्यादातर अगर आप देखेंगे जो कैरियर एडवांसमेंट स्कीम वगैरह में जो एप्लीकेशंस वगैरह आती हैं वो इसी टाइप की आती हैं, अरे क्या हुआ साहब नहीं करा तो क्या प्रॉब्लम है, लेकिन ऐसा हो नहीं सकता। ऐसी जैसे फॉर एग्जांपल अब जैसा भी है, वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट द एपीआई स्कोर, वो हो सकता अच्छा भी हो सकता खराब भी हो सकता, लेकिन इट इज़ बाइंडिंग ऑन यूनिवर्सिटीज कि भाई अगर 5 पॉइंट कम है तो व्हाट इज़ द प्रॉब्लम। लेकिन अगर ये सारी क्लैरिटी हमारे टीचर्स या हेड्स या डीन्स में है, जनरली हम क्या सोचते हैं लीडर इज ओनली वाइस चांसलर इज द लीडर इन द यूनिवर्सिटी, ऐसा नहीं है। आप लोग सब अनलेस अनटिल आप लोग सब आप मिलकर काम नहीं करेंगे तो वाइस चांसलर को भी मुश्किल हो जाएगा चलाना। दूसरी बात यह इस प्रोग्राम का एक इंपॉर्टेंट चीज़ है, जैसे ठाकुर साहब ने इशारा किया कि सही मायनों में अच्छे एकेडमिशन हैं, लेकिन ये दोनों का मिलना, एडमिनिस्ट्रेशन और एकेडमिक्स में गुड होना, ये ऐसे रेयर केसेस बहुत मुश्किल से लोग मिलते हैं। इसलिए यूनिवर्सिटीज़ की हालत जो ख़राब होती चली जा रही है उसका रीज़न ही यही है। तो कहीं ना कहीं ये सेकंड लाइन जो अच्छी तरीके से डेवलप हो पाए, इस टाइप के प्रोग्राम आपको तैयार करेंगे कि आप चीज़ों को समझें और आने वाले वक्त में जो गैप है कि वाइस चांसलर्स वगैरह के लिए, डायरेक्टर के लिए अच्छे कैंडिडेट जिनके अंदर ये दोनों खूबियाँ मौजूद हों वो मिल जाएँ, ये भी प्रोग्राम आपको हेल्प करेगा। दैट इज़ वाई मानू आई एम हैप्पी के हमारे रजिस्ट्रार सामने ये इनिशिएटिव लिया है कि एकेडमिक लीडरशिप पे ये प्रोग्राम हो, और मुझे लगता है आने वाले वक्त में 6 डे प्रोग्राम है, जिस द काइंड ऑफ स्पीकर्स वी हैव इनवाइटेड फॉर दिस प्रोग्राम 6 डे प्रोग्राम, बहुत मज़ा आएगा आप लोगों को। और मेरी आप लोगों से रिक्वेस्ट भी है कि आप इसको अच्छी तरीके से मिस ना करें, क्योंकि मैनी थिंग्स यू विल लर्न ड्यूरिंग दिस पीरियड। तो मैं ना ज़्यादा बात कह दूँगा क्योंकि अभी 11:30 ऑलरेडी हम लेट हो चुके हैं, दूसरा प्रोग्राम दूसरा सेशन शुरू होगा। मैं अपनी बात यही रखना चाहूँगा कि आप लोग ये इसका मौके का फ़ायदा उठाइए और कोई भी आप सेशन मिस ना करें, क्योंकि यू आर गोइंग टू लर्न मैनी गुड थिंग्स ड्यूरिंग दिस वीकेंड। थैंक यू वेरी मच।
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much. Now I request our director, Dr. M. A. Sikandar, sir, to give vote of thanks.
Very good morning. Assalamu alaikum. Honorable Chief Guest, Mr. Ashok Thakur, former Education Secretary, Professor Furkan Kamar, Secretary General AIU, Mr. Navin Mittal, Secretary Technical Education, Government of Telangana, Professor Sakil Ahmed, Pro Vice Chancellor, and Madam Dr. Bilgrami, and dear participants. I am extremely happy to be here because Professor Furkan Kamar knows wherever, whichever university I am there, I used to organize some set up this capacity building program. It happened in the Ambedkar University during my 2 years tenure. We also organized a similar program. Two things, as rightly pointed out by the speakers, it helps. It's a teaser. You know, in advertisement and marketing, if the commerce student, if you get to know, if we are launching an advertisement in the TV, we give a teaser. So, like it is only the training program is in a teaser for learning in your further learning in your career. And most importantly, we network with a lot of people with a diverse experience that, and sharing also helps to learn further and build up your professional relationship in that. I just want to summarize the speakers for it's giving and reinforcing the talks. Professor Mr. Ashok Thakur has pointed out school education, which serves as a feeder to the higher education, is extremely important. He talked about the role played by the Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangathan, which is in a very complex organization under the Ministry of HRD, then Ministry of Education, which transformed into in a very effective organization during the tenure of Mr. Harsman Kaire, who was an IAS officer from Assam Cadre. Fortunately, I know him, and sometime used to, when I was in Delhi University, used to conduct me, and in fact, during his regime, I was selected as an education officer. I did not join. So I know the in and out of the Kendriya Vidyalaya Sangathan. I also worked in secondary education under in the Ministry of HRD for 4 or 5 years, understand the nuances of the school education, which is important. That is the reason why after joining here, I also paying an equal importance to our model schools, which is the foundation of our university. And and also spoke about the autonomy of UGC maintenance substandard and the role of IIMs, which why they are wary about to coming into the UGC umbrella, because once they accept the award, the degree in MBA, they have to follow the norms and regulation of UGC. And he also spoke about the independence role of NAC. We all agree. And the faculty, they should be ignite the mind, which former President Abdul Kalam used to say, igniting the minds. So he also, as you must know, during his regime as a say, education secretary, first time the MHRD has issued circulars of prescribing the responsibilities of the registrars and finance officer, which is very handy to sometime to stand up before any the university administration is saying anything. You can stand up and say authoritatively. And Professor Furkan Kamars invented the three F's, that is fund, faculty and freedom. It's a very good thing. One must understand the nuances of higher education. And he also talked about the case study of Professor M. Kusru when he was a former Vice Chancellor of Aligarh Muslim University. Mr. Naveen Mittal has he brought forward an important point of the quality in higher education and interlinkages between the state universities to help to each other, and also technology intervention. And he importantly point out, we all would agree with, we are working in a very, very primitive administrative process, which files goes, and it's burdening the administrator a lot, and also it also causing inconvenience to the user group also. As you know, I don't have to say much, but one thing is very clear: the world is fast changing, so universities are not immune to the system. We have to adapt it suitably, because the university is the leading force where the creativity and the vibrancy is set. So it's also in a way it is in a leading the wherever now it become a for the registrar in a central university, it become a battleground. The role of registrar and the vice chancellor, it become now increasingly a battleground, especially you are placed in Delhi, high faced situation. where the JNU problem was going on, as a register of the Ambedkar University, I was completely, because there where the teachers, even the vice chancellor sometime has to go, you must go, I will give attendance, you must go for the dharna. So it's a very different, because this is also, somebody was telling, because it's a reflection of what is going around the university. And as a senior administrators, you all, I wish all the best, and it a lot of very good speakers we all line up, and the credit goes to the deputy director. I only giving only some set of guidance to her, and we have a lot of Dr. Pankaj Mittal is coming from UGC. Mr. There was Professor Gopal Reddy, who is a member of UGC, is coming, and Dr. K. Rama, senior advisor from NAC, will be addressing, and very importantly, IRS officer Fahim Ahmed Saab, he will also be talking. Then we will have a field trip to the ISB, where we will be expected to interact with the deans, what are the good practices ISB has been following. It is an USB in higher education, and this kind of model. And we have a lot of retired deputy, additional deputy CNDG, Mr. Sundar Raj, will be addressing, and also many other people. I will be following Professor R.K. Misra. He is a good, he is a management guru. He will be addressing, and I wish all the best. And I thank once again all the guests who are taking out time, because Delhi mein do ghanta nikalna bada mushkil hai. Yahan do din nikal ke aaye, aur uske baad. But one thing, sir, that here the Manu, it's a very green campus, and Telangana is the now, you know. It is, you know, it is there, the buzzword in across the country. I myself felt so whenever Furkan saab ko kahunga ki kabhi koi collaboration karna to Telangana higher education aaye aur Manu ko chune venue, and thank you very much, all the best. Tea will be served, thank you.